det ikke virkede, men det gør det.
Okay. Well, welcome to you all. I think the clock has passed 1 o'clock. I still see people arriving, but still I think we need to start off this general assembly in Copenhagen Fintech. Warm welcome to you all. The first thing we need to do this properly is to elect a chairman or dirigent, as we would say in Danish. And indeed, we have a very strong candidate for that position, which is Rasmus Engbæk Larsen, that you can see on your screen, from Finance Denmark. And let me know if there are any other people who want to challenge him on that position. I would assume that is not the case. So, Rasmus, you are hereby elected as chairman, and please help us through this afternoon. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for this opportunity to be your chairman today. As Ulrik rightly said, this is the General Assembly of Copenhagen Fintech. And before we go to agenda point number two, I will just shortly dwell on the requirements in the articles, and I will say if this General Assembly has been sort of announced and correctly in accordance with the articles. And as far as I can see, and I've been informed, the date was published and announced to the community in late January, which is way ahead of the 6 weeks that the article states. And that this program and this agenda was sent out 2 weeks ago, also in accordance with the articles. So everything is good on that point. And then lastly, I have also been informed that there are that the board of directors have received no proposals, and these proposals should have been received 4 weeks before today, but there has been received no proposals. So the agenda will be, as you can see on the screen, and which is in accordance to the agenda also prescribed in the articles. If there are any objections to the points that I have just stated and the things I've been through, please send a chat or say make yourself notice otherwise. It does not seem to be the case, so I think we can continue with the agenda as you can see it today here on the screen, and we will now go to agenda item or point number two, board of directors annual review, and I will shortly give the word to and back to Ulrik.
Thank you, Rasmus, and let me just say a few words on the last developments in the last year, and then subsequently Thomas will supplement me in a more detailed manner on that note. But I mean, clearly, as everywhere else, the last year has been very much affected by the pandemic. If we rewind back to April last year, I think it's fair to say there are quite some worries, and we also had some discussions on that on two fronts, you could say. One was that the COVID-19 impacted very heavily the willingness and eagerness to provide capital and funding to a lot of the entities in our community. I think it's also fair to say that the established banks had maybe other or stronger priorities than developing further cooperation with startups just in those months. Fortunately, it turned out much better than I guess we would have expected a year ago, in the sense that essentially the global financial markets rebounded strongly, and that also, of course, impacted the, let's call it, the risk appetite in the Danish financing community in terms of also providing funds and so on. So things look a lot better now than they did back in April last year. I think the same can, to a certain extent, be said about the cooperation between incumbents and startups, that we're at least starting to see a normalization in that respect. So that's really good. clearly the pandemic have had the consequence here as elsewhere that indeed Thomas and his team had to make a very rapid transition into virtual activities, but I guess a fintech community should be the one best suited for doing that. So we have managed, and I'm sure Thomas will say a little bit about that. But then again, when you talk about innovation and so on, I guess we all hope that we will over the next 12 months be able to get the physical dimension back into the way the whole community works, hopefully so, or some hybrid versions of that. If we look at other sort of major things worth mentioning from the last year, I think one of them is the fact that the government actually announced that they consider this area of fintech as a sort of competitive advantage, or as we would call it in Danish bureaucratic language, national styrkeposition, and that's very good, and it's in itself good, but it also implies there'll be some resources made available for doing projects together with universities. And so if any of you have good ideas on that note, please reach out to the secretariat and Simon and so on, and let us know. There are really resources available here to do exciting projects. Another, you could say, area that received also some funding, it's already a strong element, but it maybe exposed itself a bit, an even stronger area of focus, which is the interlinkage between the SME segment in general, in corporate Denmark, let's call it that, and the fintech scene. And I think we see a lot of promising business models developing there, able to cater to the needs of SMEs. That's also very positive development. And we'll go into further details on that a little bit later, but just to say that the economy of Copenhagen Fintech has been doing okay. Clearly, as activity has gone down, that has lowered the pressure on expenses. And so, as Thomas will tell you in a short while, the figures look good and have not created any tensions or anything like that. Let me just finish off with a short comment on where do we go from here, so to speak. And I think it's fair to say that one of the things that has been an ongoing, I guess, request or interest from a lot of you members has been the whole area of providing early capital to startups, and that has, we've been going through that back and forth in the board, and I think we are starting now to think more sort of specifically about how can we help maybe developing further availability to capital, and hopefully we can get back to you on that in over the next year. That's at least the ambition that we could potentially develop a fund that would be helpful for this community. That's at least the ambition, and now we need to explore it further, but hopefully we can get back on that. I think that was my initial sort of very broad overview of the last year. I'm sure Thomas has something more detailed and probably also clever to say about what has happened. So Thomas, over to you.
Thank you. I just want to make sure here, because there was someone mentioning that you cannot see my slides. I hope you can see a picture of Ulrich and me. And hopefully soon you will be seeing another slide here, right? At least I... Okay, good. All right. So maybe also just to get your attention, Mass has written in the chat that we would really like you to go in and change to your full name and the company you represent, because later on when we do the voting for the members to the board, we need to make sure that those actually voting all are also actually members of Copenhagen Fintech. So just a little formality and practicality to while I'm doing the management report here, you can all go and change your names. You can also write to Mass in the chat and he will do it. Anything else we should mention, Mass, just to be sure?
Not right now.
Good. Then I'll continue with going through some of the highlights from 2020 and beginning of 2021. So At the end of 2020 and beginning of 21, this report was launched, where a report or a publication commissioned by the Danish Industry Foundation and written by EY came out and used Copenhagen Fintech, which we are very proud of, used us as a successful case of cluster development. For those of you who haven't read it and have an interest in the report and the major findings, it's actually on our webpage for download. So this is, if you have trouble sleeping, this will be 50-60 pages of detailing the journey of Copenhagen Fintech from the beginning in 2015, where Finance Denmark and Finansforbundet founded Copenhagen Fintech. And then we give some very concrete recommendations of how to build a successful entrepreneurial cluster. The 9 guidelines that you can see on screen here. So of course, we're very proud of that one. And that marks also a kind of a milestone for us in terms of being recognized as a successful cluster. So just wanted to divert your attention to that report. But as I said, that can be found on our webpage. Just a little bit on the ecosystem and the development of the ecosystem. This is the latest updated map of fintech startups in Denmark. And going back again to 15-16, this has developed from around 75 to 80 companies. Now around 280 companies working within what we define as fintech in these different segments of fintechs. So it's shown, and also especially during COVID, it's shown that even in spite of a global pandemic, the ecosystem is robust and sustainable and are able to grow in spite of a global pandemic. So very positive from our perspective. Another area where it also shows a significant growth is again in terms of both number of investments, but also size of investments. You can see here back to 2014 and 15, and then how the growth has been. Of course, this is of course some major investments also both from Tradeshift, and when we do the count, we count number of investments in Danish founded companies with a Danish founder. Hence why we also put in public here to mark that this is also about Danish founders. It might be that it's outside of Denmark, but as you all know, public.com has a super interesting story of building their whole the whole development team actually out of Ballerup in Copenhagen. So when you look at the gray graphs alone, you can see that 2020 was a record year in investments. And it looks like if you take Q1 2021, it's also going to be yet another record year based on the figures already now. So it's looking really good. It's the most funded Danish tech vertical. And we're super proud of the results and the investments into Danish founded companies. If we look also at another important KPI for Copenhagen Fintech, this is the latest latest numbers from jobs created in fintech startups from 2015 Q1 to 2020 Q4, and as you can see here, it was about 750. Now around between 2,300 and 2,400 jobs created in startups alone. This is actual numbers based on CVR numbers from the companies that we know. So of course there's a little bit of uncertainty here, but this as a whole should showcase the jobs created. And then you can ask yourself, like, what's the value of a job created in a fintech startup? And we've got some pretty, and I'm sorry for this is in Danish, but if you look at the value of a job created in a fintech startup, as you can see here, and I'll just read this up in Danish, I marked it in blue. Hvis der opstår 100 nye jobs inden for finansiel service eller IT, vil det trække omkring 175 jobs i andre virksomheder med sig. Og det betyder også, at de afledte effekter vil ligge mellem, det omfatter både indirekte og hvad hedder det, afledte effekter. Og det betyder, at BNP-bidraget på 100 nye jobs i en fintech-startup ligger mellem 200 og 300 millioner kroner per år. Og hvis det er jobs, som er etableret gennem udenlandske investeringer, which I think the latest numbers we have is around 70-80% of investments into Danish fintech actually comes from the outside, så kan der tilføres endnu en effekt på 100-200 millioner kroner om året. So there's no doubt when you look at these numbers that it has a considerable impact on our growth national product when we create jobs in Danish fintech. This is a little bit that shows how the different segments, according to our numbers, the different segments in fintech, how they are growing. So you can see there's considerable growth all the way, but there is some of the segments that is growing more than others. If you take, for instance, pension and wealth tech, that's an area where we really have seen some considerable growth. Business solutions and platforms, I think we see a lot of growth there in terms of specifically open banking. But as you can see here, there's a lot of different segments that are growing very nicely. And I'm trusting that Oliver or Mass or Simon just will let me know if there's any questions or comments here in the chat here, because I'm just talking.
As far as I can see, there has been no questions regarding your presentation so far. And I can also say that it looks very, very positive. You are very good at sort of updating your name and your information as you were asked. So it looks very nice. Please continue, Thomas.
Good. So a little bit on building on what Ulrich said on a high level when it comes to 2020. And it's quite on purpose. Some of you might think, why doesn't he mention COVID? And it's quite on purpose because, of course, you know, we have felt and you have felt, those of you participating here, the impact of COVID in various ways. So I don't think there's a need as such to take a deep dive into that. We'll get a little bit back to the financial impact on the association later on when I go through the annual statement. But one of the major milestones was that we in 2020 was appointed as a economic stronghold in styrkeposition for finans and fintech, finance and fintech in Denmark. And that came to effect 1st of January 2021. One of the major things also that happened in beginning of 2021 is that Forsikring & Pension, Insurance and Pension, the industry association, joined Copenhagen Fintech and joined our board. So now the board has the four strong organizations linked into Copenhagen Fintech: Finance Denmark, Finans Danmark, Finansforbundet, Dansk Industri, og Forsikring & Pension, which is a major milestone for us in order to get the organizations involved in Copenhagen Fintech and supporting Danish Fintech, creating jobs and growth for Danish society. Another one, quite an exciting project for us, is what we have labeled SMV Fintech, Small and Medium-Sized Enterprises and Fintech, which is a project that we finalized and got supported by Industriens Fond, the Industry Foundation, which is a project that targets the broader ecosystem of Danish SMEs, and how they can optimize and make their business more efficient with digitalization from fintech products and solutions. So this is a very interesting project, and we will be working with that over the coming 2 years and be building the case for the impact of digitizing your business as a small and medium-sized enterprise with fintech solutions. So we continued building our nationwide network in 2020, and we'll continue to do that going forward, especially here in 2021, with our university collaborations. it's important to mention also that our board got expanded with university representatives now from Aarhus and Copenhagen University. Very proud and happy to have the universities also represented in our board and in the strategic development of Copenhagen Fintech. So we are building that nationwide network of partnership universities in Denmark, and also what we call the business hubs, the Erhvervshusene. We're also doing partnership agreements with them. So building both our nationwide network to make sure that we can touch all corners of Denmark, so to speak, and also the continuation of our global activities, which is supported by Industriens Fund and have been for the last 2 years. We implemented a new organization. I will get back to that to focus more on operations and deliverables, because now we are running several projects. I have a quite a complex KPI structure for the different projects. So we need to focus on operations and deliverables in those projects. So we are building an organization with a much more data-driven approach to ecosystem development, and an even more clear roles and responsibilities. We've also very much a startup, so we're evolving as a startup also. And then finally, or the final dot here, our bullet is what we are focusing on now is Copenhagen Fintech 2.0. And I think everything boiled down, you can say growing an ecosystem, an entrepreneurial ecosystem, an innovation economy as this, it boils down to two things: talent and capital. So these are the two areas of focus really going forward for Copenhagen Fintech 2.0, which was also mentioned in the report commissioned by Industriens Fund, focusing very much on the recommendation was to focus on attracting talent to the ecosystem and the access to risk capital. So those are the two points that we will be focusing on going forward strategically, alongside with, of course, all our different underlying activities of incubation and acceleration and attraction, Nordic Fast Track program, and all of these things, mentor programs and stuff like that. So those were the highlights from the management report and some additional stuff. Just to take a little bit, and I think I will take this more like an FYI, and for you to know and to ask or reach out to us afterwards, the economic stronghold, one of the requirements there is that we identify some areas of focus in terms of research and potential research projects. And so these are the seven areas of focus that we will be zooming in on when it comes for the next 4 years, when it comes to the economic stronghold. And as you can see here, and sorry again for this being in Danish, but this is implementing of AI and machine learning in fintech. It's focusing on IoT and insurance. It's big data. It's digital currencies and payments. And under that, it's blockchain. It's regulation and compliance, open banking, and sustainability. Quite broad areas that is detailed a little bit more in the following text. It doesn't mean that we cannot do things outside of these areas of focus, but these are the things that we would really like some of the potential research projects between industry and universities to focus on. And I can say we had our first call, and these are very well aligned with these headlines. So this is for our economic stronghold that came in effect 1st of January, 2021. And then I just wanted to dwell a little bit on the organization that we are building now in Copenhagen Fintech. We, in the beginning of the year, end last year, we formalized the leadership team, as you can see here, with Simon and Oliver and myself. You can see the areas of focus here. So we also, and which corresponds hopefully very nicely with our kind of value streams. So we have a value stream called corporate innovation and engagement. So there will be a new employee starting here 1st of June, Henrik Hedegaard. He will be head of partnerships and corporate engagement. So he will be engaging with all our corporate members around the innovation activities. Henrik comes from our sister organization in Norway, actually, where he was an also innovation consultant, and so knows the space good, the fintech space, the Nordic fintech space very good, and be working together with our students here. Then we have our ecosystem development value stream here, which consists of Madeline that will be running our SMB fintech project. Mass, head of intelligence. So Mass will be focusing on especially giving insights into the local ecosystem and executing some of our R&D activities together with Kirsten. Kirsten is our project manager for our economic stronghold, and especially will be working with the Danish universities around developing their focus on fintech. And then we have lab communities and startup and investor engagement that is heading up by Oliver and Naima and Andre, our new program manager, that will be heading up the different programs that we host. And then in the bottom, as you can see here, something that is very much on a focus area of us also is kind of how do we brand ourselves externally and how do we communicate to the ecosystem. That's for that's headed up by Sarah. And then we hired Sadest, which is our CRM and data expert, which will enable us to be much more data driven on the ecosystem going forward. And we'll be working together again with our students on our communication side. But especially on the CRM side, we are really ramping up and doing that with our Salesforce platform and using that as a central hub for all data collection around the ecosystem. So quite an essential part of our strategy and for attracting investors and other people to the Nordic ecosystem, fintech ecosystem. So I think that concludes the highlights and some of the deep dives into what happened in 2020 and where we will focus in 2021.
Thank you very much, Thomas. And before we can conclude this Board of Directors annual review, I will just ask the assembly if there are any last comment or short questions. That does not seem to be the case. So I think we'll thank you, Thomas, for this deep dive and for the first presentation that Ulrik gave. And I think now we will continue to the next agenda item, which will be presentation of the financial statement. And I think you will also do that, Thomas.
I will most certainly, backed up by what you can see here in the screen, one of the persons that is key to the development of Copenhagen Fintech is actually our accounting and financial planning and analysis, Tina Bay. And the reason why she's placed as she is here is we have a service level agreement with Finansforbundet, where they are supporting us on our accounting and financial planning. So Tina is sitting in Finansforbundet, but is heavily involved in the daily financial operations of Copenhagen Fintech. So she will be supporting me a bit when we go through the annual statement. And I know Tina is listening in here, even though you have a holiday, Tina. So thank you so much for that. Let me just change my slide here, 2 seconds. Just need to be sure that you can see my, hopefully, yeah, that got updated. Thank you so much. So as Ulrik already mentioned, and as you can see from our annual statement here, we have experienced, like the overall result of Copenhagen Fintech we're very happy about that. I will try to give a little bit of insights to how we came about this result. And if we start with the revenue side, what we've seen in 2020 is a dip in the partner and sponsor revenue. That primarily comes from the change we made in our structure in 2020 some of you that was on the General Assembly in 2020 might remember that our commercial partners stepped out of the board, which also meant had the consequence that they were stepping down on the financial support. So the commercial partners, so that was involved before, stepped down to another financial commitment as a sponsor. So that's the major consequence of that decrease in revenue. Of course, in a year of COVID, especially some of our foreign partners or foreign sponsors and members chose to reevaluate their commitment. I think that was to be expected. That was more than, as you can see here, our from the different programs and projects that we are running, what is called here tilskud og programmer, an increase in those, which meant that some of the decrease in partner revenue was converted into other projects and programs with our corporate partners and banks. So that's the reason for that. We applied for and got smaller projects with Digital Hub Denmark and various others. So all in all, we managed to compensate for the decrease in partner and sponsor revenue. As you can see, there's a little fall in membership fees. Not a lot. That is also to be expected, given a year of COVID, and you look a little bit extra on the expense side. If you look at the huslejeindtægter, so the revenue from our labsters, there's also a decrease in that. We, as some of you might remember, we gave a discount in the beginning of the year. To help ease the pain from some of the impact in the beginning of the year. So that's partly due to that. We, of course, tried to support the companies that needed in a period where it can be a little bit more stressful, so to speak. And so that's the main reason for the decrease here. And then we have diverse indtægter that also had a fall, and that I think, Antina, you need to help me again here just to remember the fall, but I think that was converted into some of these were converted also into programs, as far as I remember, right?
Yes, it was converted into programs, and most of the diverse income here is related to reinvoicing of expenses where we don't have any earnings.
Yeah, that's true. Thanks. So all in all, as you can see, as to be expected in a year which is challenging, there is a slight decrease on the revenue side. That is, of course, also especially when it comes to what we've been where we've been really active is of course on the globalization and internationalization of Danish fintech. The cost side of what we've been trying to do, you know, taking Danish companies or Nordic companies out, means of course that the expense side here decreases, but we have actually kept up the activity level. It was just transformed into virtual events and activities, but the direct cost side, as you can see here, decreased quite a lot from us not being able to travel and do some of the receptions and delegation trips with conferences and stuff like that we used to do in 2019. So there's a significant decrease on the direct cost of doing that. On the personal side, it's pretty much as is. And I think most of the numbers are similar, almost similar to the year before. So as you can see here, the total cost side here also decreased, which means that the yearly result resulted in 3 million, in a surplus of 3 million. And we can go that into later, but it's also important to say, as a non-for-profit, this will go into further activities and strengthening, of course, the association, but go into and be channeled into further and more activities in the years to come, because it's not a goal as such to build up a financially very, very strong association, but we need enough money on the books, and you can see that later, in order to secure our continued operations, depending a little bit on the environment. But other than that, these money will be channeled into other activities for the ecosystem on supporting either the talent or the capital. So that's the that's my words on the annual statement, resultatopgørelsen.
Thank you very much, Thomas. And as I did with the last agenda item, are there any questions to the presentation that Thomas just went through? It does not seem to be the case. Before we get to the next agenda point, where we will have a presentation of the budget and approval of the annual members fee, I will just shortly notice that we have almost all participants have been registered with full name and the company that they represent. Right now, as far as I can see, there are only two participants, one called JM and one called Peter, who we cannot identify any further. And for that matter, if you want to participate in the voting later on with regarding the members to the board, you need to register your participation with full name and company. Otherwise, you will not be able to participate in the voting to come in agenda point 5. But just so you have time to get it right, and if you have any questions regarding how to do it, please use the chat, and Mass, he will help you out to get your name and company registered correctly for this meeting. So excuse me and sorry for that short sort of side skip here. Thomas, please continue with the presentation of the budget and approval for the membership fee.
Sure, I'll do that. And just before I jump to the budget, we also have the balance here. So I think the only noticeable figure here worth maybe zooming in on a bit is Til Gode Havner. I have no idea right now what's that called in English, I'm sorry. So if anyone can help me here. Tina, I think you have, because there's a significant change since the annual statement was made. So I think you can give an approximate number of where we are now here also.
Do you mean related to the bank statement?
Yeah. The balance here on Til Gode Havner that we had two point five million.
Yeah, it's around 600,000. Last time I checked. Sorry, I didn't check because I'm on vacation right now.
No, but it's just to say that there's a significant decrease.
Yeah, exactly. Most of the outstanding amounts has been paid.
Exactly. So I think that's the most important number to focus on here. And then, as you can see here, our Eigenkapital as of 31st of December 2020 amounts to 9.1 million Danish kroners, given the result here. So then I'll just jump quickly to the budget for 2021. And as it say here, preliminary, and that's because when it comes to the economic stronghold, they were just very recently, as in within the last 14 days, actually approved. The numbers was approved by the ministry and Denmark's Erhvervsfremmebestyrelse. So this is the budget that we are going for as of now for 2021. I won't go through them all. I think they're pretty self-explanatory when it comes to the different projects we have, programs. And then, as you can see, Styrke Position, those are the economic stronghold positions. So you can see what they contribute with. And then you have the expense side also, when you can see, especially on the employee side, we've made an upgrade that is a direct consequence of some of the projects that we've had granted, which is primarily, again, the economic stronghold, SMB fintech, and then in general, just an increased activity level. So we upgraded on the employee side also. So this gives us a budget as of now, as a result for 2021, that is around 930,000, as you can see here. We also suggest, and there has been no changes in our structure and the amounts in 2016, we also again suggest this membership structure of 5,000, 10,000, and 25,000 divided on employees 0 to 10, 11 to 50, and 51 plus employees 25,000. So I think that concludes my run through of the annual statement, the budget, and our suggested membership fee structure.
Thank you very much, Thomas. Are there any questions and are there any objections to the proposed membership fees for 2021? It does not seem to be the case, so I hereby suggest that we approve those membership fees for 2021. And with that, I think we shall continue to agenda item number 5, election by non-partner members of the board of directors. And before we go into that, I hope also, Mads, that you will support me and supplement me if there's something that I misses. At present, as you can see, this is the members of our board. There are 3 members that are up for elections among non-partner members. And at present, they would be Frederik Moormann Lindme, and they would be Charlotte Ronje from Jamie One, and it would be Stine Kalmer Jørgensen from Green Plan. Those are the 3 non-partner members that have been elected and were elected last time. Before we go into the election and before we go into the actual voting, we need to ensure, and we need to sort of just focus on some practicalities, because as I mentioned before, it is very important for you in order to vote that we can identify you. We will vote by using the poll function in Zoom. And if we cannot identify you by name and company, we will not be able to assure that you are eligible for voting. So therefore it is important. So if you are registered with this General Assembly right now in the participants list without a name and company name, your vote, if you cast it, will not be counted. Important. So please contact Wright Mass in the chat if you want to participate in the vote. Once we have started voting, we will actually start it as a poll, and then we will keep the poll open for 10 minutes, and then we will close the poll, and we will also actually close this meeting. And this is due to a functionality within this Zoom, because for us to get data that confirms how you voted and who voted on which candidate, and ensure that no member is voting twice on the same or twice at 2 different candidates, we need to get the data, and that data can only get that data once the Zoom meeting has closed. So therefore, we will start the voting. It will be open for 10 minutes. Then we will close this meeting, and then for the next 10 minutes, we will open the new meeting, where we will then sort of present you with the result that we have been able to also reassure and assess. And but that will be in a new and different link. So I will need you all to leave this meeting, and you will from Mass receive shortly a new link where you will join up, and then we will share with you the result of the election. And once we do this, we will start the voting. The voting process will start in 3 minutes, so we'll start exactly at 1:50. And then the voting will last for 10 minutes. This means that this meeting will be open up until 2:00. Then this meeting will be closed. Shortly thereafter, we will reopen the new meeting with the new link that you have received. And then no later than 10 minutes past 2, we will reconvene with the meeting, and we will share you the result of the vote. So please let me know, please write, make a note if you have any questions or if there are anything that you are not sort of that has not been clear so far, how this voting procedure will continue. And Mads, have I forgotten anything? Or Thomas, for that matter?
No, I think maybe just a slight formality. We also mentioned that the board also consists of some partner-appointed board members, which means that Sten Michael Eriksen, Peter Sleit, and Rolf Kjærgaard will be continuing in the board also. I think that's just a slight formality, but just mentioning.
I have another thing. This is Mads from Copenhagen Fintech. So in order to vote for whoever runs for the board, you have to be a member of the organization. And this means that this also means that member organizations only get one vote, meaning if several people from the same company is on the call, only one vote will count. So if you are several people from your organization on the call, please talk to each other to figure out who votes and who that person votes for. Because if we see in the system that your organization has two different votes for two different people, we'll have to contact you and figure out who you are actually voting for. So instead of doing that, which would slow down the process, please talk to each other, if you are more than one person from your company, on who of you decides to vote. That's it, yeah.
Good. And as you can all see now in the chat, Mads has pasted in the new link for the new meeting. I would suggest that you all copy and paste it into some notes or something, because once we have closed down this meeting, you will not be able to access this link. So please ensure for all practical purposes that you sort of keep that link. So you have access to it once we have closed this meeting, and this meeting will close at 2:00. So, and I think right now it is exactly 10 minutes to 2. So if there are no further questions, Mads, I think please let us know. We actually forgotten to give the the candidates a short presentation. Sorry, I was just so focused on the practical things here. So here we have Stine, and we will have all four candidates. You will get a chance to give yourself a short pitch of two minutes, and if you are too long, I will cut you off. But please, Stine, give yourself your short pitch and presentation.
Yes. Can you confirm that you can hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So my name is Stine Kalmer Jørgensen, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of Dreamplan. Dreamplan is a self-service holistic financial advisory service. I have a background in the established sector in Danske and in Nykredit. And in November 19, I started Dreamplan and moved into the lab. I'm up for re-election. I have been on the board for the last year. In Dreamplan, we work really closely with the established sector. And I would like to continue to work for and with the established sector to define clearly IT security frameworks, compliance frameworks, and exchange of talent. We closed a pre-seed round in the beginning of the year, and I continue to see a need for a dedicated fintech fund, which is also one of the areas that I've been working on, inside and outside the board. So if you want someone to fight for closer cooperation with the established sector, between fintech and established sector, and to push further for a dedicated fintech fund, you should vote for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dina. And I think on the point 2 minutes, and the next candidate number two will be Charlotte. Charlotte, the floor is yours.
Charlotte, you should be promoted to panelist now.
Okay. Yeah. And can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Great. Thank you. So yes, my name is Charlotte. I'm CEO and co-founder of DemiOne. We are a little bit an odd one out because we work primarily as a fintech company in developing markets, so in Ethiopia and other African markets primarily. We're very much born out of competition in the Copenhagen Fintech, the accelerator program, the mentor program. We also had InnoBooster and innovation loans from the Danish ecosystem. So we know what it's like to be born out of the Danish fintech environment, but we're also born global. So we're born with a focus outside of Denmark, and that's really my focus in everything we do. We really need to attract more investments and also international talent to Denmark, and we can do that. We can do that because we have a very strong impact profile, and that's something I have worked with in my previous companies and also in my current. And we can do it because we also do have talent and innovation here. But for us to really do this, I do believe that we need to play on an international scale. We do need for many of the fintechs to be going international, going into other countries, but also to be born global from the beginning. This will really light the investment scene up for us, especially as it really is tricky to get the first investments, but Series A's is really what kills companies. So if we want to get to that scale, I believe we need to be more international. We need to play to our advantages, which is our sustainable profile, our strong GDPR profile internationally in the investment sector. So for me, I'm very much about internationality, globalization, impact, because that's my background and also what we work with today. I've been with the board for 1 year and enjoyed the experience, and I would like to continue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Charlotte. And next one up, candidate number three, Frederik. Floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Hope you can hear me all. My name is Frederik Merman. I'm the co-founder and CEO of LendMe. LendMe is a transparency platform or comparison platform for financial products. And I've been working in the industry or the banking industry since 2006 until I chose to create LendMe with my two co-founders in 2016. We were actually the third company or fourth company, if I remember correctly, that moved into the lab, one of the first there. And I think we've been tried it all from a very immature fintech market to basically growing from us three founders to 16 people. We also have gone through the process of establishing partnerships with 14 different banks in the Danish market. And it's also looking at going abroad shortly. I think that what I come to the table with is a deeper understanding from basically a seed company to building it to scale and also managing the partnerships with the financial institutions that we all want to have. And that's my focus in our future tenure and what I've been focusing on. I think also the fact that moving out of the lab provides certain difficulties with keeping relations with the community. And that's also something that I want to promote and work for in my future tenure. And the last thing is that I think I can provide some insight on the side of building a fund next to Copenhagen Fintechs due to us obviously also raising money, but having a good understanding from both the startup and the industrial institutional side of the industry. So please vote for me if you want a company that's tried it all, basically. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Frederik, and you were also good on time. And then the last one here, Peter from Tink.
Yeah, you should be promoted to panelist. Yeah.
You can hear me now?
Yeah.
Excellent. So Peter Anderson, I'm the country lead of Tink. Happy to be part of this call. Tink obviously being the European open banking leader with a lot of elements, a lot of partners, a lot of use cases across all the different European countries. And I think one of the things that we bring to the table as a company is that we are involved in so many different areas, partners, entities across many markets in the European, not just fintech, but financial, insurtech, and other elements. So we have a broad connection and a broad experience with a lot of those entities and elements. So with my 10 years plus experience in a SaaS company with different kind of companies moving across different regions and taking a product from one level to another level, one of the elements I can bring to the table is taking that leap out of little, big Denmark, however you perceive it, to some of the other markets. And we've seen that, and we have developed our platform and investigated partnership or instigated partnership with other partners across the European marketplace. So that's part of the things that we can bring to the table, together with the fact that we enable new functions and we know what it takes to scale inside and outside a market. And I'll be happy to take some of that to the FinTech lab and the whole community. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. And you also seem to community. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Thanks.
Yes. Thank you very much. You are also on time. And thank you all four candidates that had announced their candidacy in advance. We should also note that it is possible to be a candidate here at the meeting. So I will ask, are there any of you participants at the meeting who wants to also run for a position in the board? You can actually announce your candidacy right now, and you will also get a 2 minutes presentation if you want to do that. But please, if you do, write in the chat that you want to run for one of the seats in the board. I will take the silence as an indication that there are the four candidates that you have just heard from and their short presentations, and those are the four candidates that you will be able to vote for in the voting that will start very shortly. But just again, one vote for each company, and as Matt says, please ensure that you only vote once. We will have the voting open for 10 minutes, then we will close this meeting and reopen the new meeting where we will share the results no less than at this point 20 minutes past two. So the meeting, the new meeting and the new meeting link will and the meeting will reconvene at 20 minutes past two, and now it's 2 o'clock. And if there are any questions, please put them forward now, or otherwise I will suggest that we start the voting by mass opening up the poll or the voting. But are there any last minute questions or remarks? No. Mass, please open the voting.
It should be on, and I'm just saying, Mads from Copenhagen Fintech again, the reason that we're going on the new link is because in Zoom we can only check which email voted for who 5 minutes after the meeting is closed. And therefore, when we close this meeting, we'll have to wait 5 minutes until we can actually check the report to see who voted for what. So it will take some time for us to first get the report and then go through the votes to check that every vote came from a member, and so on and so on. And that's why we are doing it like this.
And of course, maybe just mention, just as a practicality and formality, that it's been possible to gather fullmakter, power of attorneys. So they have been collected by us. So when we present the numbers, those numbers will include those power of attorneys being given out to the different candidates. So the numbers won't necessarily add up to the amount of people participating in the call here, just if anyone wonders.
Thank you for those comments and supplements. And this is also the reason why we need some minutes after this voting has ended to ensure that every vote is cast according to the proxies that have been given or and have been cast by members who are who can do so. So once you have voted, you can actually you are free to leave this meeting. And as I said before, we will reconvene no later than 20 minutes past two. So if you have voted, I will suggest that you check in around 10 minutes past in 7 minutes or so, or because then the new meeting will be open. But just to ensure that we have all the formalities in check, we will reconvene as soon as possible, as we can, but no later than 20 minutes past two. So I think we will, from the panel, we will mute off now, and we can just see how the votes, if we have gotten all the votes that we expect. So see you in a little while in the new meeting.
Just like to ask the audience, because in my Zoom, it seems that 100% has voted. If anyone in the meeting has not voted and are still thinking, please write it in the chat, or else we'll stop it in a minute or two instead of in 7 minutes. So please write if you're still thinking, or else we'll close it in a minute or two instead of waiting. Asmus and Thomas, I think we can call off the voting. What do you say? It says 100% has voted and no one said that they are still thinking of who to vote for. Asmus, you're muted.
Okay. Can everybody hear me now? And also, yeah. Also the audience? Okay, but I'm just trying to use Teams instead. But I think we can do that. I have just been told, as you just can hear, Massa, that everybody has voted now. And then we are at 100% and nobody has said that they wanted to vote but did not have the opportunity to vote. So I take it as a sign that everybody who's participating in this meeting who wants to vote actually also have had the chance and have voted. So therefore, we will close the meeting now, and we will get back to the other meeting, and we will see you there soon. And as I said before, we will continue when we have a result, but we will continue no later than 20 minutes past two. So we will close this meeting now and also close this session, and it will not be possible to vote from this point on. So see you on the other link.